Let's talk about some of the ways that you can get exposure to real estate as an asset class, but we'll also talk about some of the avenues through which you can enter the market. So one of the things that we need to understand is that real estate has historically been a wonderful wealth creation asset for a lot of wealthy people. And of course, it comes with its risks. And in this session, I really want to talk about some of the ways that you can get exposure to the property market. So let's talk about the first way. And there's a thing called a property trust. And a property trust is basically when you have a number of people get together and they set up a fund which is legally authorized by an authorizing body in your particular country. And the people who run the fund may go and buy a number of assets, and typically it's a diversified fund where they might buy one commercial property in one location, a couple of residential properties in another location, or it might just be a combination of commercial properties or a combination of residential properties, or it might be a tourism-based property, it might be an industrial property. And how they raise capital is by asking investors to provide some capital so then they can be a part of that investment pool. And as an investor, if you don't have enough money to be able to get into the property market to be able to buy a property directly, but you have a little bit of money that you'd like to invest and you prefer property as an asset class, you could consider these property trusts. And what happens is, let's just say you and I decide to set up a property trust and we go and make an offer on five or six properties. We may be sitting on some capital ourselves and then we want to raise the rest of the capital by inviting subscriptions from other investors. What happens is we have a larger pool of money, and from that larger pool of money that we get from investors, we can then buy a number of properties. And when those properties grow in value or they provide an income, we distribute the growth and income to our investors. And we may have some rules about when they can enter, when they can exit, and there might be some charges as well for them to be able to enter into those property investments. So think about, as an investor, sometimes you'll have the opportunity to be a part of a property trust or a property pool, but you'd want to be very careful because the liquidity in these assets is not very high, which simply means that if you needed the money, it's very difficult for them to be able to give you your money back, because typically your money is locked into the purchase of a bulky asset, meaning the property that the property trust has bought. So it does come with its risks. And the other thing is, a lot of people have lost a lot of money with property trusts as well. So you'd want to check the prospectus, you'd want to check the track record of the people that are running the fund. And you'd want to also get some information on the underlying properties that make up that asset pool for that fund. And based on that, you can decide whether or not it's worthwhile for you to invest in a property trust like that. And you'll also typically have investment minimums that they will need before you can become an investor. But these are some of the considerations, and this is one way that you can get exposure to the property market. The second way to get exposure to real estate or property is through what we call fractional property investing. Now, fractional property investing is a relatively new idea, and based on my experience in the finance industry, I anticipate that it's going to become more and more popular, just because there are so many young people who just don't have enough money to be able to buy a full entire property. And fractional property investing, very similar to a property trust, it simply means that there might be four or five people that pool their money together to buy one property. And typically there is somebody who's running this type of arrangement, and they run some sort of a trust where the money is sitting in escrow. So let's just say you, me, and a couple of our friends get together and we want to buy a property that's typically valued at 400,000, but we don't have 400,000. Each one of us can raise 100,000 each. We might decide to go into this property together, but you would typically go through a provider who provides fractional property investing services. You would give them that 400,000. They would buy that property on your behalf. They would manage that property. They would manage the collection of rent on your behalf, and they would take a percentage of everything, but they would manage the entire property portfolio. So fractional property investing is also a way to be able to get into a single property and have a share in a single property. It could be a 10%, 25%, 50% share, just depending on your affordability and the property that you're buying. But effectively, it's another way of being able to get into the property market. And You can certainly research if there are property, fractional property investing providers in your country, or sometimes you can even invest in property through funds that are investing in properties overseas. So you might want to look at property trusts that are in other countries as well. Again, you would never put too much of your money in one place. Remember, if you're going to invest in real estate or shares or anywhere else, remember, it again needs to, you have to give consideration to the quality of the asset, and you have to give consideration to diversity of strategy and diversity of investments. You never want to put too much money in any one place, and you always want to do your due diligence. And typically you'll find that a lot of property trusts have not been around a very long time. So my personal opinion is that when it comes to risk, there is a much higher risk in going with a property trust compared to a mutual fund or an ETF that's been around a lot longer. But that's not to say that you shouldn't do it. Sometimes people really want to get into the property market. They have a little bit of money. They can't buy direct property. So investing in property either through a property trust or through fractional property investing, both provide a way for them to get experience or get exposure to property as an asset class. Now, when it comes to who you should buy from, there is a number of ways you can buy property. You can just do your own research. Typically, there are a lot of online channels where most real estate agents now have their listings. In Australia, we have realestate.com.au. And you know, you can do your research that way, and you can decide based on your own research, you can decide to buy a property. If you're comfortable that you've done enough research, you're comfortable that you have a good plan, you're comfortable that you know exactly how much you're going to spend, and you know what kind of property you're going to buy, then you can just do it yourself. The second way that you can buy a property is through a real estate agent. Now, real estate agents are typically obviously in the business of selling a property, but they're usually representing the seller, not the buyer. So don't expect them to work for you. Their job is to get the maximum amount of money from you, because that's how they typically get paid. I know that in some countries, the real estate agents get paid both from the buyer and seller. If that's the case, it may be worthwhile for you to develop a relationship with the real estate agent. Let them know exactly what you're looking for. And if you feel that you can trust them, that's another way for you to get buy properties, through the advice that they give you. The third way that you can buy property is through what we call a buyer's advocate. And a buyer's advocate is the polar opposite of a real estate agent, where a real estate agent predominantly works for the seller. The buyer's advocate typically works for the buyer. So they will take either a fee or a small percentage of the purchase price of the property. But what their job is to do is to find you a high quality real estate asset that has a lot of potential for performance based on the criteria that you've given them, so that you're minimizing the risk. And I have personally bought property through a buyer's advocate, and it was one of my best performing properties. But again, I did a lot of research, and I found out a lot about the person, how long they had been operating, their own property portfolio, how much money they had made in property, their credibility in the marketplace, their expertise, and their philosophy around property investing before I decided to go with them. So that's another way that you can look at investing in property, is through a buyer's advocate. And a fourth way to buy property is through what we call a property researcher. And property researchers sometimes will either charge you a flat fee, or there'll typically be salespeople that are representing a developer who has a large number of properties to sell. And the property researcher will either charge you a fee, or they will get a commission and that on the property that they sell. And typically the commission comes from the developer, but for the developer to pay them a commission, the property is sold at a premium price. So it may be that if you want to avoid paying an agent, and you want to avoid paying a buyer's advocate, and you want to even avoid paying a property researcher who charges a fee, you may decide to go with a property researcher that simply takes a commission from the developer, because you're not having to pay for that. But just be aware that the downside of this strategy is that when you buy property through a property researcher that is working for a property developer, you may be paying a slight premium on that property. Now, is that a bad thing? Well, it depends. It could be a bad thing if you're overpaying on that property by 2-5%, then you're obviously going backwards before you can go forward, and you'll need a little bit more time to make up for that loss. But sometimes it's not a bad thing, because if the property researcher has identified an area where the properties are yet to go up, and they have some knowledge around, you know, some government spending that's about to happen in the area, and they have good connections with the developer who has providing the property researcher the ability to be able to sell properties at a discounted price, then it could actually work in your favor as well. And all depends. There is no hard and fast rule. There is no guarantee that, you know, if you go through a property researcher, you'll make a good investment. So one of the things that I would do is, if you decide to go with a property researcher, I would ask to speak with the clients who bought property at least 5 years ago to see what their experience was. So I would not speak to the new clients. I would speak to clients that bought property a while ago, because in that way you can assess whether or not those properties made money and how they feel about that property researcher. I would personally have some reservations about getting recommendations from a property researcher who is new in the marketplace. And I would probably be more inclined to pay a fee to a property researcher or a buyer's advocate personally for myself. But that's not to say that I'm completely opposed to the idea of buying a property through a property researcher who is taking commissions from a developer, because I know that in many cases those kind of transactions I have seen, and the clients have done extremely well when they've purchased a property like that. So it all depends, but again, this is all about, you know, not going in blind. It's all about applying research and due diligence before you commit to a strategy, so that you're giving yourself the best chance of making a good decision when it comes to your property investing, for you to become a future millionaire.